This emerald in the turquoise sea, this Coral Cay, was not always here. A few hundred years ago, it was merely a bare sandbank, just above high tide. And before that, a submerged coral reef. Mother Nature created this island from the sea, born from the relentless waves which slowly hit the coral sand into one big pile, which rose above high tide. Birds flocked to the new land and deposited fertilizers and seeds. Bushes sprang from the sand. Now this vegetated coral cay is a complex ecosystem, and the creatures who come here still maintain a vital link with the sea that surrounds the island. Let me show you the secrets of a coral cay. The coral reefs of the South Pacific are mere youngsters in Earth's evolutionary history. Recent core samplings prove they are maybe a half million years old and were totally annihilated 12 times during this period. The constant surge of waves across the reef pound the coral into rubble and eventually pulverize it into fine sand. A sandbank forms on the lee side, awash at high tide, constantly growing higher and higher. Seasonal storms threaten to wash away the infant cay. Often the storm waves pile up rubble and sand to consolidate the bank. It may take hundreds of years for the sandbank to become an island speck above the high tide. Still unstable, with wind and wave action constantly reshaping it. This new ocean platform attracts seabirds. The island, born from the sea, is completely naked. There are no nutrients, no growth. Seabirds choose to make it a new nesting site. Their droppings and discarded fish add the first nutrients. Seeds are carried in their feathers from another island, and the first of the creeper plants and grasses take hold. A dense colony of crested terns lay a thousand eggs in a clearing among the low vegetation. Their numbers are trampling the vegetation and retarding its growth. The brown booby arranges the dead plants to form its nest. Juvenile frigate birds are almost ready to fly. The tropical sun is merciless through the heat of the day, and the tern chicks seek out any little shade. The best is under the wing of the mother. It looks like this chick is under the wrong wing and starts a neighborhood brawl. All this violence rubs off on the chicks. Parents are watchful as the chicks take a dip. Currents, surge, and especially sharks pose a danger. King tide brings chaos to the nesting terns. Abandoned eggs are swept away by the tide. Predators swoop in. Seagulls and turnstones devour the eggs. The terns watch in bewilderment. Scurrying ghost crabs lick clean the broken shells. In all the confusion, a seagull snatches a tern chick. A thousand mouths cry hunger. The bountiful lagoon waters will provide. Baitfish like these hardyheads also feed schools of trevally fish. A feeding frenzy is a signal for the birds to come and take their share. Terns swallow as many fish as they can possibly carry. Back home, they somehow locate their own chicks and disgorge the meal into famished mouths. Terns now nest on this cay. Many years will pass before the island outgrows the dominance of the tern colony. The coral cay is born from the surrounding reef, and that bond remains forever. The lagoon waters teem with fish life. Some fish species actually contribute to the cay's growth. Schools of parrotfish graze on the coral, constantly grinding it into sand and spewing it out on the lagoon floor. Their production of sand is enormous. Triggerfish uproot the rubble floor in search of food. The disturbed sand moves with the surge. Tuskfish busily rearrange the rubble landscape. While the fish dig and disturb the sand, the crown of thorn starfish kills the coral and adds to the rubble pile. Thousands of shrimp dig burrows. They loosen and turn over the rubble floor. Waves wash the rubble toward the cay. The shrimp fights an endless battle against the shifting sands. Carrying his home on his back, the marine hermit crab lives a life underwater in the lagoon. The terrestrial hermit crab remains on the cay for most of his life. In the heat of the day, the crab seeks out any shade. A dead bird will do, also part of its diet. When the day cools, the terrestrial crab briefly immerses himself to renew the small amount of seawater held in his shell. The female must also seek out the water to release her eggs. The young pass through the larval stage as members of the plankton community before returning to dry land. A growing crab needs a new shell. The exposed tail is soft, vulnerable, a tasty morsel for any bird. There are dozens of washed-up shells to choose from. This one looks made to measure. The discarded shell suits another crab. In the crystal clear water surrounding the cay, a ponderous predator awaits. A tawny shark, nearly 3 meters in length, spends much of the day lazily circling the cay. It's looking for an easy meal. The cay is a natural attraction for both predator and prey. A big shovel-nosed shark also patrols the beach. Octopus is a delicacy. This octopus is intent on capturing a sand crab and is willing to dig for it. When all 8 arms are buried in the sand, the shovel nose seizes the advantage. Amazing! The octopus has somehow slipped out of the shark's jaws. The wily octopus has a charmed life. The nesting seabirds have retarded the growth of vegetation for many years. From out of the ocean comes the next change. A 100 coconuts have washed up before, but all have died. This one finally takes hold. The cay's first tree. The seeds of many island plants, like this box fruit, are resistant to seawater and designed to disperse by the ocean currents. The seeds are dormant during the long period afloat, but when washed ashore and soaked by rainwater, they germinate. Islands far away help to vegetate this coral cay. Strong winds blow butterflies over the ocean, but grasshoppers migrate by chance. This one stayed with a palm frond when it fell into the sea. The first thing this sailor does is to wipe the salt from his eye. Many of these driftwood migrants are transients that never become established. If they do not find a mate, they become extinct. The gecko, Labidodactylus, has solved this problem. She's a parthenogenetic female, which means she can lay fertile eggs without the need of a male. Our Coral Cay has come of age. The coconut trees are tall. It's now a fully vegetated cay. Many of the plants are halophytes, species which can tolerate high levels of salt spray on their roots and leaves. They propagate and thrive. Existence is still precarious. Extinction is common. A beetle may graze on a particular plant until it eats that plant into extinction. Then the beetle is doomed unless it changes its diet. Grasshoppers and caterpillars are voracious feeders. There are no predators to control their population. Over the life of the cay, they will cause the extinction of many plants and themselves, and then the slow cycle of migration and establishment begins once more. Vegetation becomes established in an orderly fashion. Halophytes are on the outside, resistant to salt. Those which disperse seeds by the ocean hang over the beaches. Deep inside the cay is a jungle of rainforest plants. Like any rainforest, the fallen and rotten logs add nutrients to the soil. The trees literally feed off themselves. The ecological succession from grassy vegetation to tall trees has also changed the nesting habits and the species of birds. Pigeons now nest on the cay because it has trees. Their seed-rich droppings litter the forest floor. This guano is the island's most important fertilizer. The tallest, oldest tree is crowned with an osprey eagle's nest. The chick has only a week or so before it will take wing. With three mouths to feed, the breeding pair are forever fishing. The catch is taken to a tree and is partly eaten. Competition for food means no meal is eaten in peace. The hungry chick is eager to finish off the meal. The ground nesting terns have been replaced by their cousins, the tree nesting white-capped noddy terns. The noddy terns rely on summer storms to build their nests. The rain softens fallen leaves. As quickly as the rain stops, the terns collect the sodden leaves, which pack down much better in the nest. Their droppings cement the leaves together. For 2 months of the year, flying foxes utilize the cay to bear their young. While the baby suckles on her breast, she gently fans her wing to keep the infant cool. With the greening of the island, there is little open space for the birds who nest on the ground. The brown booby is replaced by the red-footed booby, who prefers to nest in the trees. Others are the frigate birds and the musk gannet. 8 bird species are nesting here now. Life was not meant to be easy. On its first attempt to fly, the chick tern is caught in the bramble bush. Mother pigeon watches helplessly as a chick slips out of the nest. If it falls, it will surely die. Some seeds stick to the birds for dispersal. This one proved a fatal load. For 3 months of the year, the forest floor is thrown into a state of turmoil. Mating wedge-tailed shearwaters squabble all night long. As juvenile frigates grow, they begin to defend their treetop territory. Initial wing testing is downgrading. The actual flying lesson starts by trying to get back into the tree. Hidden in the sand, a flathead snaps at food. Many marine creatures utilize the shifting sands surrounding the cay. A well-armed blue swimmer sand crab enjoys a prawn meal. Guess who's coming to dinner? The dauntless victor spies a female. Her sack is bursting with eggs. Blinded by desire, the crab has not considered her larger size. Not wasting time on subtlety, she snaps off his claw, and he beats a hasty retreat. The school of hardyheads are sufficient in numbers to also support a colony of nesting pelicans. Migratory wading birds fly south from the Arctic and feed around the cay in the non-breeding season. The sandpipers come from Siberia, an astonishing 40,000 kilometre round trip. The black-tailed godwit hails from northern Asia. Soldier crabs hide beneath the sand and erupt into marching legions at low tide. A tasty morsel for the swift. The sand crab has good reason to hide. It's a delicacy to many fish, but they have to first get past those menacing nippers. The octopus, which rode the shark, is destined to play another role in the drama of life and death at the Coral Cay. A giant groper likes octopus. It also likes crab. For a thousand years, the Cay has seen occasional human life. They first came in frail canoes with primitive goggles and harpoons to fish the abundant marine life. Fish, birds' eggs, turtle eggs and turtles were gathered and taken back to their village many kilometres away. They made little impact on the Cay's creatures, even less than its natural predators. Only in the last century has the human impact increased. Guano miners dug into the Cay for its fertilizer. Cray fishermen, pearlers, troca shell and beche de mer collectors swept the reef clean. The Cay survived this brief commercial onslaught. Its own precarious progression against the elements, cyclones, droughts, plagues and predation, far exceeds man's intrusion. They still come to catch a turtle and picnic on the beach, building a sand oven of hot rocks to roast the turtle. If we care to use the Cay wisely, man will have little impact. Now it is the tourist's turn to come to the Cay. Lynn, Dean, Adam and I enjoy snorkeling the lagoon waters and marvel at the luxuriant corals, the multitude of colourful fish. The living reef is only a few thousand years old, the latest phase in a cycle of growth and decay. The reef has built on the bones of its forebears, each generation of corals adding a thin veneer of living beauty on top of a mountainous, rocky graveyard. A school of big trevally, not too politely, compete for the fish scraps Adam and Dean have to offer. Lynn's flowing hair looks enticing to these fish. No, it's not seaweed. Low tide exposes the reef flat, an area of patchy corals and shifting sands which feed the cay. Flotsam becomes irresistible treasure to the boys. Since the beginning of sail, the reef has posed a threat to navigation. An old sailing ship has come to grief here, her anchor put out in a vain attempt to warp the ship off the reef. Her bones finally washed ashore onto the cay. What has become of her crew?
I wonder whether it's from the castaways that far back or the beach de mer people, because they set up a camp here. Could be either one.
The primeval coconut crab has the same link with the cay and the sea as the terrestrial hermit crab. The water it takes up on a quick daily dip will bathe its gills during its time on the land. These prehistoric-looking creatures dominate the forest floor. They are so formidable, they can even crack open a coconut. The husk nut is held in one claw, and the crab climbs a tree. T- 10 metres high, the crab lines up a solid target below. The meat is easy to get at now, but its aroma attracts an unwanted dinner guest. Their battle will not be won on the forest floor. These largest of all land crabs are heading for extinction. They are now a prized delicacy, over-collected for tourist restaurants throughout the Pacific. The tawny shark is skidding over what is called beach rock. It was formed under the cay itself, the sand grains binding it into a cemented mass. Rough seas and wind erode the cay, and this beach rock, the base of the cay, becomes exposed. Shellfish colonize the rock at the tidal zone, but further inland, where the rock is steep and cliff-like, nesting turtles tumble to their death and form a graveyard of bones. The coral-eating fish, along with the wind and waves, sculpture the beach rock into nooks and crannies that shelter many creatures, such as this sea urchin and the venomous blue-ringed octopus. Crabs scuttle over the exposed rock, and moray eels live in the sheltered rock pools. These two do not lead a peaceful coexistence. When a wave dislodges a crab, the eel is quick to take the advantage. Marine scientists Andy Dunstan and Gareth Johnson come to the cay to study its unique ecosystem. First, they prepare to collect droppings from a pigeon's nest to discover what it's being fed.
Oh, little fellow, let's see what your mother feeds.
Okay, right on the edge of the beach rock here.
Yeah, just across the ridge.
Wind that one back across to the other edge.
Yeah. Just here will do it. That's 8.5, Andy.
8.5 metres. So a long way for the cay to move in a year, isn't it?
Yeah, it's done well.
Okay, there's
got it.
Okay, good shot. Let's get him in the shallows a little bit. Yeah, he's a big fella, this green. Alright, measuring that. Length along the back there. Mm-hmm. Shell carapace. Right off there. Yeah, 95.
95.
Alright.
Just
look at that. Just check. I think it's big male, this guy. Yeah, you can see the spurs there on the flippers. Yeah, and these guys right at the front too, look at that. Yeah. All righty, we might let them go now. All right, see you in the following year back at the same island.
There we go. Bye.
Gareth is collecting bêche de mer. They're an important preemptive indicator of any environmental degradation caused by agricultural pollution from the mainland many miles away.
All right, good specimen.
Yeah, I've got this one just out there, or atria. Just need to cut it up, and just see what we've got inside.
Right.
Looking at the guts and the gills, mainly.
Cadmium, lead and mercury can accumulate to a toxic level in the environment from a pollutant source. Holothurians are sediment feeders. And if there is any heavy metal pollution around the cay, this will accumulate in the fleshy tissues of the creature.
Yeah, and obviously passing sand straight to the guts.
Right, so that's the main spot you're interested in then?
Yeah, that seems to be the most active site, along with the gills. We'll look at the body wall as well, because
laboratory tests show the cay waters are still pristine. Dusk is the best time to take a pigeon census.
Coming in thick and fast now, aren't they?
Another three.
Yep. Right, and another big flock coming in here too.
12
in that one.
Yep.
Yeah, this is the real peak.
The pigeons proved to be a significant contributor in transferring mainland rainforest seeds to the cay.
Yeah, good start to the rainforest here. This young fellow, I think I'm sure, is appreciating it too. Yeah.
There is no greater destructive force than a cyclone. It can change the whole face of the cay. The cyclonic rains are welcome at first. There are no catchment areas, and the sand swallows up the rainwater with an unquenchable thirst. The beach is heavily eroded, reducing the cay in size. The erosion spills turtle eggs into the sea. Batfish promptly swallow them. The forest edge is devastated. The trees still standing are stripped of all their leaves. The fallen trees will soon decay and add more nutrients to the soil. Their dwellers, the nesting birds, are strewn dead along the beach in their hundreds. No babies, no eggs survived the onslaught. The force of the waves have smashed the beach rock into slabs and tossed them ashore to form a rock wall where the sandy beach once stood. Nature is resilient in her power to regenerate. The forest regrows. Waves move more sand shorewards to replenish the beach. And life goes on. The green turtles are mating. An enamored male doesn't seem to know three's a crowd. Each turtle may have swum more than 1,000 kilometres for the big event. The sky is ablaze with life. Within the hour, the cay will become a beachhead for an invasion of turtles. The female has a special bond with the cay. She has nested here many times before, ever since she reached maturity at about 50 years of age. Perhaps she was even born here. Her greatest enemy is the tiger shark. Mating is a long, tiring task, especially for the female, which makes her an easy target. The first charge splits the pair. The male escapes. The tiger is in no hurry. He follows the female on the surface, hounding her each time she rises to breathe. She slows down, surfaces more frequently. The tiger moves closer. The tiger grabs her flipper. The end is near. Weeks pass. The sun incubates the eggs and the baby turtles hatch. They remain under the sand until it cools and they know it's dark. They face less predation if they run for the water at night. In an unexpected quirk of nature, the storm cools the sand and falsely signals the babies it is time to emerge. Their headlong rush leads them to the beach edge, and the waiting seagulls swoop in. Ghost crabs take their toll. The tawny sharks, dogged circling of the cay, may finally reap him a bountiful meal. Faster fish beat him to the hatchlings. The survivors swim out to the deep ocean and remain there for years. Only a few of the hatchlings will reach maturity and perhaps return to their island of birth. Over the centuries, similar happenings have conditioned the local whaler sharks. They know that when the stormy sky blocks out the light and the rain cools the sand, the turtle hatchlings will emerge, believing it's night. The sharks take full advantage of this cruel trick of nature. The visiting natives set baited hooks to capture some of the sharks. Inside the shark's stomach is more than a dozen baby turtles. To us, the suffering of any wild creature is abhorrent. But life and violent death is a natural cycle on the Cay. The sands of time still return to the sea a great number of living turtles. The Cay's ecological succession, from bare sand to tall forest, was greatly influenced by the sea around it. Now that the Cay is fully matured, more resilient against nature's storms and whims, only man has the power to jeopardize its future.